Friends, in this lecture, today we shall discuss about the infections of the upper urinary tract. A young, recently married female patient comes with fever, with chills and rigors, frequent urination and dysuria. How will you proceed to investigate and treat this patient? Another patient, a small child, 3 years of age, is brought with failure to thrive, anorexia, fever, and anemia. How will you manage this case? Yet another patient, a young adult male patient, comes with straining, poor stream, fever, dysuria and frequency. How will you manage this patient? Friends, the learning objectives of this lecture are to understand the infections of the upper urinary tract, to know the symptoms of kidney infections, to know the special situations of kidney infections, to understand chronic and tuberculosis infection of the kidney, to know the role of investigations in these cases, and to know the treatment modalities in renal infections. Kidney infection can be broadly described under the following headings: acute pyelonephritis, especially in childhood, in pregnancy, honeymoon pyelitis, despite routine acute pyelonephritis, kidney infection with urinary obstruction, chronic pyelonephritis in a routine case or with reflux nephropathy, pyonephrosis, renal abscess and carbuncle, perinephric abscess, and catheter associated infections. There are various normal mechanisms that maintain the sterility of urine. One, this can be adequate urine volume, the free flow from kidneys through the urinary meatus, complete bladder emptying, the normal acidity of urine, peristaltic activity of ureters, and competent ureter-vesicle junction, increased intravesicular pressure preventing reflux, and in the males, the antibacterial effect of zinc in prostatic fluid. All these are some of the factors that try to maintain the sterility of urine. Any disturbance in these factors, along with an attack of organisms, can cause urinary tract infection. E. coli and other gram-negative organisms are commonly responsible for urinary tract infection. In E. coli and streptococcal infections, the urine is acidic, with Proteus and Staphylococci splitting the urea to form ammonia, which makes the urine alkaline and cloudy and promotes the formation of calculi. Friends, acute pyelonephritis is much more common in the females, especially during childhood, at puberty, after intercourse, that is after recent marriage, as a complication of honeymoon pyelitis or cystitis, during pregnancy and during menopause. Thus, the bacterial flora in the vagina in a female keeps on changing due to the puberty, the first menstrual cycle starting, that is a menarche, after intercourse, during pregnancy and during menopause, and therefore the females are more susceptible to pyelonephritis. It occurs more on the right side, but is more frequently bilateral. Pyelonephritis can be defined as inflammation of the renal pelvis and the parenchyma, that is the functional kidney tissue, and it results from an infection that ascends to the kidney, usually from the lower urinary tract. It can occur from blood-borne infection as well. The risk factors for pyelonephritis are pregnancy, urinary tract obstruction and congenital malformations, urinary tract trauma and scarring, renal calculi, polycystic or hypertensive renal disease, chronic diseases like diabetes mellitus and vesicoureteric reflux. The clinical features of acute pyelonephritis can be, there can be prodromal symptoms like headache, lassitude and nausea. There can be acute pain in the flank and hypochondrium, just like a renal colic but less severe than renal colic. It can be associated with fever, with rigors and vomiting. If the pyelonephritis is severe or associated with obstruction, or if the obstruction is bilateral and the infection is bilateral, then the patient may have uremia. There can be risk of life-threatening septicemia with acute pyelonephritis. It is much more common in females, as we saw just now. It is often associated with septicemia leading to pyrexia and rigors, associated with pyuria and occasionally hematuria. Should be initially treated with broad-spectrum parenteral antibiotics and is extremely dangerous if the kidney is obstructed. The investigation that one needs to do in a case of suspected pyelonephritis are hemoglobin and a complete blood count. The complete blood count normal should be in the range of 4 to 10,000. In a subacute pyelonephritis, the WBC count may be anywhere from 10 to 15,000. But a count more than 15,000 to 20,000 indicates severe acute pyelonephritis and warrants parenteral broad-spectrum antibiotics to prevent further septicemia. Urine routine and microscopic examination may show pus cells with or without RBCs. And if there are pus cells, we can do even bacterial examination and culture and sensitivity of the urine to know what type of bacteria and what antibiotics are they sensitive to. Ultrasonography is done to know whether there is any obstruction to the urine flow or the urine tract or any other anomaly or any other pathology is there in the kidney like stones. X-ray abdomen KUB may be done along with USG for seeing the exact size of stone. An IVU may be needed if one suspects obstruction but there is no stone seen. Micturating cysturethrogram is done to rule out reflux of vesicoureteric nature. The special situations of pyelonephritis can be pyelonephritis of pregnancy, pyelonephritis in childhood. The possibility of urine sepsis should always be considered if a child fails to thrive or suffers unexplained fever. Pain or screaming on micturition may occur. Up to 50% of children with urinary infection have an underlying anatomical abnormality, like it can be a reflux or obstruction. A single proven urine tract infection in a child should prompt referral to a pediatric urologist. Acute pyelonephritis associated with urinary retention may also occur. The treatment of acute pyelonephritis should be prompt, appropriate, and prolonged. Antimicrobials with a wide range of activity, such as amoxicillin with or without gentamicin or other aminoglycosides, should be given parenterally. The patient should drink water copiously. If this is not possible due to nausea and vomiting, IV hydration should be set up. Recurrent infection is there, is likely if there is an untreated underlying abnormality of the urinary tract, such as a stone, a vasico-ureteric reflux, or a fistula to the GI tract, or the retention of urine. Acute pyelonephritis may lead to chronic pyelonephritis, which is a common cause of end-stage renal failure, often associated with ureteric reflux, may be symptomatically silent, and may lead to progressive renal scarring. The clinical features of chronic pyelonephritis can be, it is 3 times more common in women. 2/3 of female patients are under 40 years of age, whereas 60% of male patients are over 40. Lumbar pain, dull and non-specific, may be present. Increased urinary frequency and dysuria also is there. Patient may have malignant hypertension, lassitude, malaise, anorexia, nausea and headache, and low-grade fever are the features of chronic pyelonephritis. Treatment is aimed at eradicating predisposing contributory factors such as obstruction or stones and or reflux, and treating the infection often with repeated courses of antibiotics. Progressive renal damage is common and may require renal replacement therapy later. The next type of urinary infection can be pyonephrosis. Pyonephrosis results from the infection of a hydronephrosis, but can follow acute pyelonephritis or more commonly arises as a complication of renal calculus disease, also known as calculus pyonephrosis. Pyonephrosis is usually unilateral. The classical triad of symptoms is anemia, fever, and a swelling in the loin. Pyonephrosis is a surgical emergency. A large percutaneous nephrostomy or open nephrostomy and removal of stone or nephrectomy are the options of treatment available. This ultrasound picture shows calculus pyonephrosis. Renal carbuncle is another form of kidney infection where then an abscess can form in the renal parenchyma as a result of blood-borne spread of organisms like coliforms and Staphylococcus aureus. It is more commonly seen in diabetics, IV drug abusers, those debilitated by chronic disease, and patients with acquired immunodeficiency. They present as ill-defined tender swelling in the loin, persistent pyrexia, and leukocytosis. The differential diagnosis can be a perinephric abscess or a renal cell carcinoma. Resolution by antibiotic treatment alone is not very common. Formal open incision of the abscess may be necessary if the pus is too thick to be drained by percutaneous aspiration. This ultrasound picture on the right side shows a carbuncle in the kidney. On the left side, it is showing the photograph of a kidney with a carbuncle. Perinephric abscess is another way of kidney getting infected, and the causes can be hematogenous. It can be via periureteral lymphatics because of an extension of a cortical abscess, extension of an appendicular abscess, infection of a perirenal hematoma following trauma, perinephric discharge of an untreated pyonephrosis or a renal carbuncle, or it can be an extension from a nearby tuberculous vertebra. This picture shows most of the common causes of perinephric abscess, like hematogenous spread via periureteral lymphatics as an extension of the cortical abscess or extension of an appendicular abscess. The clinical features of perinephric abscess can be high swinging fever, abdominal tenderness and fullness in the loin. The WBC count is always markedly raised, but there are characteristically no pus cells or organisms in the urine. The Schwann shadow is obscured on the plain axillary abdomen. There may be a reactionary scoliosis with concavity towards the abscess and elevation and immobility of the diaphragm on the affected side. A calculus may be present in the kidney. Ultrasonography and CT are diagnostic of a perinephric abscess. This picture shows a clinical photograph of a large perinephric abscess. One can manage a perinephric abscess by a collection of pus in and around the kidney. Should be drained surgically if they cannot be aspirated by percutaneous needling. The next important infection of the kidneys are the chronic infection, that is namely renal tuberculosis. TB can affect any organ in the body wherever there is blood supply, and kidney is also one of the important stations for TB infection. Renal tuberculosis can occur because of various reasons and can take various forms. Hematogenous infection from a distant focus, usually the lungs. Lesions are usually confined to one kidney, being the most common site. Tuberculous granulomas in a renal pyramid coalesce to form an ulcer. Mycobacterium and pus cells discharge into the urine. Lesions further enlarge and a tuberculous abscess forms. Necks of the chalices and the renal pelvis get stenosed by fibrosis, confine the infection so that there is a tuberculous pyonephrosis. Extension of pyonephrosis or tuberculous renal abscess leads to a tuberculous perinephric abscess, and the kidneys progressively replaced by caseous material is called as putty kidney, which may become calcified and called cement kidney. At any stage, the plain X-ray may show areas of calcification, that is pseudocalculi. This is the pathology of renal tuberculosis, can be arrested at any level once the patient is diagnosed of renal TB and aggressive treatment is started. These are the photographs showing the various stages of renal tuberculosis. There can be tuberculous papillary lesion. There can be cavernous form in the lens to bursting of a bombshell like thing into the pellucular system. There can be hydronephrosis. There can be pyonephrosis secondary to infection. Tuberculous perinephric abscess can occur, pseudocalculi, caseous kidney, and miliary tuberculosis of the kidney. The clinical features of renal tuberculosis can be, it occurs generally between 20 and 40 years of age, is twice as common in men as in women. Urinary frequency is the earliest symptom. There is sterile acid pyuria, by which means There are pustules in urine. The urine is acidic, but on culture, there are no organisms grown. Renal pain is dull or absent. Dysuria is there only if bladder is involved in the tuberculosis process. Hematuria may be there. Malaise and weight loss are usual, and a low level evening rise of temperature is typical. Renal TB should be considered when symptoms of cystitis continue despite treatment with antibiotics. It is a cause of sterile acid pyuria. It results in chronic inflammation and scarring throughout the urinary tract, which may continue after anticoax treatment has been instituted and may cause obstructive lesions throughout the urinary tract. One can investigate a case suspected of renal tuberculosis by doing urine routine and microscopic, and by asking the laboratory to do urine AFB for 3 consecutive days. If one does it for 3 consecutive days, the positive yield may be in the range of 50 to 60%. An abdominal X-ray may show calcified lesions. IVU shows calicial stenosis and or hydronephrosis, thimble bladder, hydroureters, and multiple ureteric strictures can be seen. Chest X-ray may show pulmonary tuberculosis. RGP can be helpful in diagnosis when not proper delineation is there in IVP. Cystoscopy may be done in hematuria or unexplained bladder symptoms, may show tuberculous granulomas, thimble bladder, or a golf ball ureter. The IVU in renal tuberculosis, early TB, the only radiological abnormality may be an irregularity or destruction of one or more papillae, and the most sensitive modality to detect it is IVU. Advanced changes such as calcification may occur in any part of the genitourinary tract, especially the kidney and ureter. Cavities may be seen in the kidney. Fibrosis leading to obstruction may be seen at the fibrotic strictures of the pelvis or the ureters that can lead to hydronephrosis. Strictures of the calicial neck may lead to hydrocalcosis, and bladder changes in the form of thick walled bladder, trabeculated, small and contracted, and in later stages there may be vasico ureteric reflux. This picture shows an IVP. On the left side there is erosion of the papilla, and there can be a roundish cavity seen marked by the arrow, and on the left side there is gross tuberculosis of the right kidney and the ureter with multiple strictures at multiple levels. This X-ray shows a cement kidney. The treatment, once we have diagnosed renal tuberculosis, a full course of anti-TB treatment gives good results in early TB. Surgery is needed only occasionally in renal TB. It may be needed to treat strictures at the PUJ or in the ureter. Surgery may be needed for thimble bladder, that is small, contracted, fibrotic bladder. Nephrouretrectomy is the last resort in a completely damaged kidney. This is a specimen of nephrouretrectomy in a patient whose kidney and ureter is grossly damaged by the tuberculosis. Friends, at the end of this chapter, we come to some multiple choice questions. Most common route of infection in the kidney TB is hematogenous. Most sensitive imaging modality to detect early renal TB is again an IVU. In genitourinary TB, true is sterile acid pyuria is a consistent finding. A patient with alkaline urine, which is cloudy with plenty of pus cells, is suffering from infection with proteus, and renal TB originates in the renal papilla. And the classical triad of clinical features in pyonephrosis are anemia, fever and loin swelling. Thank you. To summarize, kidney infections. These are some of the slides for you to just recapitulate the lecture. Thank you.